Are there questions?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Yesterday you said in the three examples you gave, so first two examples you said are trivial. I mean,
when those you can easily visualize. When two of the features training operators come close, right. Like feature training operator and vortex operator come close, there's an operator expansion, right, which blows up. Okay. So it's still not degeneration in the usual sense, right, but at least you can visualize because two operators are coming close to each other. So in that sense, they are trivial. Okay, doesn't mean that you still have to avoid it.
And they can be avoided by using the.
But it's exactly the same trick, yeah. Because for that trick, all you use is that it's four dimension two. The singularities occur in the data, real four dimension two.
Yeah. So you have this, because I mentioned two surface of spurious pool.
Yes.
And so in the PEGMN, you have several of them at various places. And is there an instance like when two surfaces like collide or something like this, and can you have problem
yes.
With
so we'll discuss
the section?
Yeah. Yeah, so what I discussed was in fact that's the tip of an iceberg. We have to worry about when two such surfaces collide and so on, right? So we describe systematically how to do this. Right now what I'm describing is more an impressionistic view of how you go about solving. There will be issues when two surfaces
collide. Any other questions? I have one simple question.
Yeah.
Why are the pools are at on the co-dimension two subspace?
Because it gives a condition on one complex combination, right? So that means it's two real equations. So if you look at when zeta collision of two, take collision of two big touch any operators, right? That corresponds to zeta equal to zj, right? So that's two conditions because the real parts have to be equal, imaginary parts of the have to be equal, right? So in PGMN, it's a co-dimension two subspace, right? Because it's you have two conditions of the variables of PGMN.
So it doesn't depend on what kind of singularities you are getting, like 1 by z to the power n. Z square, 1 by Z.
Yeah, in this case it happens that each of them are 1 over Z. Right? They are poles. Right? But sometimes two poles may collide. Right? Those will be higher dimensions. Yeah, so it doesn't matter for the discussion that we have had so far. We have not assumed that it's Z or Z square. Right? All we have assumed is that the correlation function of the size is a well-defined correlation function. That if there are singularities in psi, it doesn't matter if you go around one way or the other way. The integral of del psi gives the same result. Yeah, so the degree of the singularity hasn't played an important role so far. Is this okay? Okay. So, I mean, more precisely, what it says that in a correlation function like this, right, when you calculate the correlation function involving del psi, Lzi of course has poles, singularities at the locations of various vortex operators, right? Because Lzi with beta has a singularity. But the residues at all the poles are zero. Okay? So there are poles, but their poles are of higher order. Okay? So when you calculate the residue must be zero. Because if the residue was not zero, then the integral of Lzi around two different cycles would have given different answers. Exactly. That's the end of the soundproofing improvements, right? The outside of the sound will come soon.
Smoke-proofing? No, it's smoke.
This form is
the fog.
Smoke-proofing is also
good.
Right? Smoke-proofing.
Yeah, I don't know if it's smoke-proof.
Fogging.
Yeah.
Yesterday you said, I mean, we cannot have vertical, I mean, these poles, I mean, vertical co-dimension to singularity.
Yes.
Cannot it happen then halfway it goes like doing wiggly things and then it becomes vertical?
The body, if it becomes vertical, right, that means that it's that it happens at some fixed point on the base, right?
Yeah.
So at fixed point on the modular space. There is no such singularity that happens at a fixed point on the modular space. Right? Because see these poles are appearing because of the picture changing. Right. So, in the absence of picture changing operators, these poles are absent. Okay. So there is always some dependence on some picture changing operator of any of the spurious poles that you consider. Right? That also depends because in the argument of theta, right, where the arguments of xi, eta, if you define, right, those are all which appear in the picture changing operator. So poles going vertical, right, that's not there in this. Okay, so let me then try to describe two different viewpoints on what we had been doing. So one viewpoint, which I, in fact, which was the starting point, is more intuitive, okay, but it's not rigorous. Okay, it's not rigorous in the following sense. So let's recall what we did. So we are doing integration over PGMN, right?
Integration over
subspace. And you considered a subspace of the following form. Okay, today I'm going to draw a two-dimensional subspace. I'll give you more euclidistic. So the kind of surface we took and a shape like this. Okay, you have to make, if you want to try to make it a two-dimensional thing, just imagine that you revolve this diagram around the vertical axis. Okay. And the reason we did it is because there are the spurious locus of spurious singularity. Because here, so you couldn't have continuity in the interior because the two-dimensional subspace would have gone through the spurious singularity. So you assume that the spurious singularity locus is like this, and we intersect the locus of the spurious singularity. So that makes the integral over S1 and S2 completely well defined. There is no encountering of spurious poles. Yeah, along S1 and S2. This part, C, okay, the vertical part, it does encounter spurious singularity. But the way we dealt with this, okay, is to note that by definition the vertical part is the one where we have taken one particular location of the VCO to vary, leaving everything else unchanged. Okay, that was the definition of going vertical. This was something like Z1. And in that case, when we take omega p, in general we are interested in omega 6t minus 6 plus tm plus tn, but take any omega p. And if you are trying to integrate over c, we have to pick the Z1 component of omega. Okay, otherwise, the result will vanish because one of the tangent vectors of this surface is along the Z1 direction. So need to pick the part proportional to dz1 and that in some sense requires that we insert this minus delta z1 dz1 into the correlation function, okay, because this is the only source of dz1 inside omega p. And then we said that if the bottom is z1 hat and the top is z1 tilde, which of course can vary as you move along the circle or the discard along the base, we can integrate this from z1 hat to z1 tilde and get xi of z1 hat minus xi of z1 tilde. And this correlation function, because it involves xi at the bottom and the top, okay, none of which have anything encountered the spurious singularity, the correlation function involving xi of z1 hat minus xi of z1 tilde is completely free from any singularity. Okay. Okay, so you do this part of this vertical integral first and then you integrate. If we think of this as some kind of curve, then we have a cylinder. Okay, and on top also there is a similar curve. Then you integrate over the base.
Sir, this design term we introduced to all of it by finding that identity holds.
Yes, exactly.
So that identity is impervious to the fact whether we have spurious poles or not.
Well, yeah. So the point is that identity, we don't know whether it's impervious to the point whether it has spurious poles or not. But if you take this to be the definition of omega p, then this integral holds. Okay. And then once we have defined integral of omega p this way, we can go back and check if that identity holds. Okay. And in fact, it is more or less obvious that the identity will hold because you are dealing with things which do not have any spurious pole, right?
And also the taking del xi to feed the
two
means the integral of omega p in such a way such that it feeds the
identity. Exactly.
Sorry.
Yeah, but the one it will hold, it's okay. So let me, I'll explain in what sense it holds. Okay. So the point is that if you think of it this way, of course the final result is independent of, doesn't encounter spurious singularity. Okay. But nevertheless, the starting point looks a bit odd because it does have a surface going through the spurious singularity. Right? And in a sense, we are saying that this is a prescription for how to integrate over the spurious singularity, okay, simply by utilizing the fact that integral of del psi, okay, whatever you define it, it doesn't matter. Okay, it's dependent only on the initial and final points. Okay. So this is intuitive, okay, but nevertheless, it may be one may worry about whether it's rigorous because we have this thing coming in. Okay, it's of course perfectly well defined at the end. So there is another viewpoint that one can take, okay, which is more rigorous, okay, but it's not intuitive, and the various identities that we have to prove involving this, okay, again, are not completely intuitive, but can be proved. So this viewpoint is, so this was the first viewpoint. The second viewpoint is integration. Over MGM. Okay, this is a moduli space of Venus Gilman surface with M NS functions and N Ramon functions. Okay. So let's begin by considering a regular section of PGM. Okay, we know what is the section. Okay, and see how integral over a regular section can be thought of as an integral over MGM. So take a regular section. Yes. Okay. So what does this mean? This means that there is a map from MGMN to PGMN. Okay, which you can call it this. Okay, that given a point in MGMN, we have a point on PGMN just by going up. Okay, regular section is like this. Okay, given a point on MGMN, you just go up and pick the corresponding point on PGMN. So given a section means that there is a map from every point in MGMN to the point in PGMN. And this allows us to take any P form on PGMN. So this is MGMN. This one is PGMN. So you can take any P form on PGMN and pull it back to a P form on MGMN. Okay? So let me make it more explicit what one means by this. So let's take a omega p, okay, this is a p form on PGMN, which is a linear combination can write this as I over T. Recall that you had used the x's and z's as the coordinates on TGMN. The x's you have from the transition functions. The x's are the coordinates that entered in labeling the independent transition functions. Z's are the locations of the picture taking operators. Okay, so a general P form will have this structure like this. Okay. And given a section, means that we have x is as a function of m, z as a function of m.
So what is m?
M is a coordinate on x. M, oh, I shouldn't have used m, so let me see what we use w. So w is a coordinate on m. So take some coordinate on MGMN. So take W as a coordinate on MGMN. To give it a section, I have already said that it. So I should also call this A sub W, right?
Coordinate of MGMN by using the modular video.
Pardon? Yeah, modular space. Yes, the modular space of Riemann surface with genus G and M. Okay, so these are modular space, but it also involves locations on boxes. Okay, that's the introductory exercise. So we are given these functions x's of w and z of w. Okay. And pullback basically means that you just substitute f for x, this function, okay, to convert all these into w. Okay. And similarly the z's in terms of these functions, converting everything into w. Okay. So dx's will be replaced by del xs xs and dw alpha, and similarly dz a will be del a del alpha z a and dw. Okay, so that gives a P form on the modulus on the MGMN.
They require the location of PCO and
yes,
they require the transition function. Then, so in a form, but it's a form of PGMN. So why don't you have some lakes along the MGMN GMN direction as well? I mean, why all the lakes are in fiber direction?
No, all the lakes are not in fiber direction.
Some of the x's are.
Some of the x's are actually x also. I doubt it. Okay. So those x's will be dx equal to delta. So for those the map is trivial, right? That's what I mean, when you talk about a section, I mean it's not arbitrary map, it's some special map in the sense that S of W, right, part of the coordinates on PGMN involves the MGMN coordinates also, right?
Mm-hmm.
Those are just W itself, because they are going vertically up. See, when you talk about coordinates on PGMN, right, those coordinates contain information about this as well as this, fiber as well as the base, right? So for the, as far as the base coordinates are concerned, right, you just set the equal to whatever w was. But the fiber coordinates are also given as a function of the base coordinates. Is this clear? Okay. So this is a formal way of getting the pullback. But you have also described a more direct way. Okay, we don't have to construct a full forms on this infinite dimensional space and then pull it back. Okay. All you have to do is that you just specify the transition functions as a function of m directly. Okay? By making special choice of transition functions. That's what corresponds to choice of a section. Okay? Specify the transition functions as a function of the coordinates on m. Okay. Specify the z's as a function of the coordinates on M, and directly substitute the expression for omega p, get everything in terms of dw alpha directly. Anyway, so the pullback of omega p on MGMN is quite natural and it's easy to construct, right? From procedure that you are best at. Is this clear? So right now we are not talking about spurious cones. We will now come to spurious cones. So, right? I'm saying if you have a regular section, okay, then the pullback is easily defined, right? But of course you know that we cannot have a regular section with the spurious cones, right?
So the placement of indices on Z doesn't matter up or down.
Well, no, I mean I'm not disturbing you because that's a metric to raise and lower, right? I mean I can take it down. So none of these, I mean I'm not introducing any metric anywhere, right? So upper and lower index are the same. So this pullback will call omega p of s. Of omega p using this section s. This is omega p s. Okay, this is a preform on MGMN. Okay? And the point is that integral of omega p over the section S, okay, this is viewed as an integration in PGMN. Section S of PGMN, the subspace S, is the same as integral over MGMN of omega p of S. Okay, that's how pullbacks are useful. So, yeah, you just rewrite the integration over the section, okay, using the coordinate system on MGMN, right? Because MGMN corresponds, I mean, can provide one particular coordinate system, intrinsic coordinate system of the section. Is this clear? So two different sections will give you two different p forms. And even though the omega starting omega p is the same, the integrands will be different. And then the relation that we used, that omega p qba. Okay, I'll now use a more abstract notation, but we have it first. Relationship of this form, right? A here will stand for A1 to M, A1 tilde to N tilde, okay, all the points of order, right? And QB will stand for some point from 1 to plus N to BI. So basically, the BRST operator acting on each vertex operator in term. Okay, so this is an abstract way of writing this. So this is on PGMN, this is the relation on PGMN. This will translate to the following relation on MGMN. Omega p of S QBA is minus 1 to the power p d omega p minus 1. is how it goes. Yes. This is a less known. AB. Okay, so basically the point is you have any relation that you have on PGMN, you can pull back both sides using the same section. As long as you pull back both sides of using the same section, the relation continues to hold. Okay? And D basically commutes to the pullback operation. Okay, so if you first take D and then pull back, or if you first pull back and then take D, it's the same. Because all the identities that you had derived on PGMN from using the geometric description, then now you translate it to corresponding results here. See, on PGMN, for example, you use Stokes' theorem, right? Given two sections, the integrals over them, okay, give the identical result of total derivative, we use Stokes' theorem. Now, on MGMN, of course, there is no Stokes' theorem as such, right? So, if you are integrating over the whole of MGMN, both integrals are running over MGMN, right? So the difference there is in omega. Okay? In one case you are using the section S to pull back omega p, in the other case you are using the section S prime. Nevertheless, the fact that the difference is a total derivative, that can be derived in the simplest way by thinking of them as integrals on PGMN. Okay? Because when you think of this as an integral on PGMN, it's clear that given two sections, the difference, okay, you can write an integral of q omega p in between, okay, and then apply Stokes' theorem, and then apply, you know, this result. Okay? So to derive various results, okay, it's useful to work in PGMN. Okay? But to define the various quantities that you are going to work with, okay, you can always work with MGMN, okay, keeping in mind that the P forms that you are going to define on MGMN depends on the choice of section. Okay, so finally you have to see independence of the choice of section and so on.
This combination
is possible even if P greater than 6 minus 6. If you do that, then it will be 0. On MGMN, when you pull back, it will give you 0. How it gets modified when you have these vertical segments. So consider integration over subspaces of PGMN. Okay, which basically means, again, to draw the diagram again, okay, you have some situation like this. Okay, so you'll call this, let's call this S1. Well, this is a part of the same subspace. Okay, you think of this as what this is, and this is C. Now, as far as the integral over S1 and S2 are concerned, let me write 6 minus 6 plus 2 minus 2. This is what I write this. This can be written as integral over MI GMN. So what is MI? This is the projection of SI onto any single element. Okay, so basically now you just project S1 onto MGMN, right? That will cover part of MGMN. You project S2 onto MGMN, that will cover another part of MGMN, okay, which are calling M1 and M2. Okay, and that's what gives you this. But there is a piece left over, okay, which is the integral over C. Okay. And you have to see now how to interpret this as some integral over MGMN or its subsets. Okay, because you are trying to pull everything back now to an integral over MGMN. So we will call, in fact, yesterday I think we used the notion B bar. Okay, so let's call this surface B hat, B tilde. Okay, so these are the subspaces of PGMN, okay, B hat and B tilde, and both project down to D bar in MGMN. But D bar is codimension, real codimension 1. Okay, so B bar has a shape like this in MGMN. Because if you recall, right, the spurious pole intersects this on a codimension 2 subspace, right? So you cut out a codimension 1 circle around the surrounding the spurious pole, right, and then get to the center, right? So in MGMN, this will be a codimension 1 subspace. Here, on, so now MGMN is a plane, right? So the fibers are in this direction. So you have erected a cylinder somewhere in this direction. So it's clear that the integral over the cylinder, this part, okay, the vertical segment, will effectively be reduced to some integral over this B bar. This is B bar.
When we pull back B tilde is the disk.
B tilde, there is a boundary of the disk.
It's a
boundary. Yeah, S2 is the integral, right? That we have already taken care of. Okay, so B hat and B tilde are the boundaries. Okay, so on B hat, Z1 is given by Z1 hat of W. Okay? Now W belongs to B bar, and on B tilde, Z1 equal to Z1 tilde. W, again W belongs to B1. Okay, that's what, so Z1 hat is the Z1 value at the bottom, Z1 tilde is the Z1 value at the top. Okay, at the same value on the modulus, on the base. So the result that we had found yesterday, now I'll translate to a specific statement of what form we have created over B1. Okay. Now it's clear that because B1 is codimension 1, the degree of the form will be 6z minus 6 plus 2m plus 2m minus 1. Okay. That's the form of created. Okay. So let's call omega bar of p bar omega of c, put the omega function of this cylinder, okay, this part of the section. This is a 6u minus 6, that's 2m plus 2m minus 1 form. Okay, and I'll now tell you how to construct it. So, first step is that we replace x of 0 1 minus del x, sorry, del z 0 1. Is a one in the definition of omega p by minus by psi of the one at minus psi of the one. These are functions of W. Okay, W belonging to the base, which is the P bar. And then we replace and rest of the ZS by XS of W and Z A of W.
The rank of the form increases by 1.
Well, no, at the first step, the rank of the form doesn't decrease by 1 because omega p has been defined for all p simultaneously. If you remember in the definition of omega p, right, we are given the definition as an infinite expansion, right, of form. So at the first step, we just make this replacement and you define arbitrary omega.
But there you have a dz1. And here you don't have a d something. So
yeah, but you can, you could in principle pick all the other dz. So there are many other dz and dx's in the definition of omega p. Right? So because omega p has been defined in this peculiar way, right, at the first stage itself you cannot say the rank reduces. Okay, but eventually okay that is the reason rank reduces. But so the operational definition of how to construct the form that will integrate over b bar is that first you replace this x of z1 minus del x del psi z by this, and for the rest of the z you do exactly what you do for normal pullbacks. Okay? Then we replace them by their corresponding function on m, because you can see that on the cylinder, right, as you go up the fiber only z1 varies. Okay? So all along this cylinder z2, z3, etc. takes the same value, right? So they can be thought of as a function of a base chord that you are worrying about where you are on the cylinder. Right? Only z1 couldn't be thought of as a function of a base coordinate because z1 is changing even though the base coordinate is not changing. Right? As far as z2, z3, etc. they are functions of the base coordinate because they remain constant at the coordinate. Right? Okay, so for them you can exactly the same.
the main points we could change the name.
Only the?
Z1 hat and Z1 hat.
Yeah, so you replace this by this, okay, and then for the rest you just think of this as x as a function of w, and a function of w, right? W being a coordinate on the base, okay, and pull back to get a code and then get a appropriate form on this v bar. You could have gotten a p form for arbitrary p less than this dimension, because this is the dimension of the v bar, right? But we pick up the top form, because that's what you want to integrate over. Is this clear? Okay. So this means that to do this vertical integration, so define this vertical integration as an integral over MGMN, okay, what you have to do is that you have an integration over this, which is by the usual pullback, okay, integration over this, which is by the usual pullback, okay, and then you have to add a correction factor on the boundary between these two regions. Okay, and that correction factor is the integral of a 6g minus 6 plus 2m plus 2n minus 1 form, okay, which is constructed in this fashion. Is this clear or not clear? No, this is the result that we found. Whatever result we found yesterday, right, can be interpreted this way. Because when you read the vertical integral, right, we replace the del xi 1, we did the del xi 1 dz down integral explicitly. Okay. And for the rest, it was the usual treatment, right? So those you could pull back and get this as an integral over MGMN. Okay. So yesterday's analysis, right, can be summarized by saying that this is a prescription that we found, okay, for defining the integral as an over MGMN.
For me, third point is the expression we got yesterday, which was over b bar.
Yes, exactly. Okay. But this is the algorithm by which you can construct that form. Okay. That, so the algorithm is simply that we first drop this, okay, replace it by this at the beginning. Okay. And then for the rest, we think of the z as a function of the base coordinates, the x as a function of the base coordinates, right? So all the trick there, all the transition functions, okay, regarded by the function of the coordinates on the MGMN, right? The location for the feature changing operators from 2 to n, regard them as functions of the base coordinates, and construct the appropriate form. Okay, just in that form, there is no further dz1, okay, which has to be pulled back, okay, because dz1 is not there, we have dropped this all together.
Basically, you are doing the integration and putting it in. Doing the delta zeta integration and putting it in the definition.
Exactly. But the point is that if I define it this way, then from the beginning we have no spurious thing. We are just telling that this is a correction term you have to add. Okay. And if this is part of the definition, then the fact that we have integrated to spurious singularity, right, that is hidden in the way it appeared, but it doesn't appear in this description. So you could think of defining the integral, integration to spurious singularities, just as this prescription as to what you have to do in the moduli space to avoid spurious singularities. So as far as the MGMN is concerned, what you are doing is that you are choosing some PCO locations outside this region, some PCO location inside this region, okay, and you are closing them in such a way that there is no spurious singularity here, no spurious singularity here. But if you are trying to continue this all the way inside, you would have hit with spurious singularity. Okay. If you are trying to continue this all the way outside, you would have hit with spurious singularity. Okay. So the price you pay is that there is a discontinuous jump from the PCO locations here to here. Okay. On the boundary, right, as you come from this side, you will hit z1 hat. As you come from inside, you will reach z1 tilde. Okay. So you are making a jump on the PCO locations from z1 hat to z1 tilde. And you have to compensate for it. Okay, that compensating part is this one. That you have to integrate this all over the boundary.
But MGMN does not include the PC location.
No, MGMN doesn't, but omega p does. So when you define omega p on the pullback of omega p, right, right? Here you are using a section S1 to pull back. Right? Here you are using the section S2 to pull back. So those pullbacks will encounter spurious singularities in general because those contain information about the section that you have used to pull it back. Right? So it will still appear as in the integrand, okay, that you are using in this region and in this region. Is this clear?
Suppose I do not know this generalized section construct and I start with from there. So at that level, is there some motivation of adding this correction term?
Well, the motivation is that it will satisfy all the desired identities. Like what you can get using Stokes theorem, etc. from PGM. But here you have to do more work to prove that. So whatever identity, after all, this is a perfectly well defined expression, right? So whatever identity you want to prove, you should be able to prove using this. Okay? Without ever having to go back to this picture. Okay? Because there are well defined expressions. Right? So if you satisfy some identities, you can prove it. Okay? It's just that it is easier to prove it, at least intuitively, see how the identities work by going to the PGM. Okay? But this, in a sense, is a more rigorous. Because here in this definition, you never talk about integrating spurious singularities at all. Right? All you are saying is that you make the spurious, you have made the location for the PCOs jump. Okay. That here you choose one kind of section, one kind of PCO locations, here you choose another kind of PCO locations. You make them jump across this boundary. Okay. And the price you pay is that you have tiny correction term on this boundary. Is this clear?
So this prescription is unique. I mean, can we say that this is the only prescription that will satisfy all the desired properties?
I mean, if you have one PCO, this is unique. I mean, I don't know of any other prescription. Okay, I don't know that one can prove it.
Yeah.
But this, for example, one can check the various different. Okay, once you go to two PCOs, okay, it will become clear that there are more than one prescription.
Okay.
Yeah, but the equivalence can also be proven using the same intuitive idea.
Yeah, one PCO, if you make a jump, I mean, only the difference can
exactly
come. So there is
yeah
not much
choice. There is not much thing you can do.
In principle, a piecewise continuous section would have been okay for them. In the small hyperspace.
Yeah, everything is between the small hyperspace. Yeah.
No, but you are right. We are replacing that del xi by xi.
But this is still in the small hyperspace because the xi naught is subtracted out, right? The difference in xi between two points is still in the small hyperspace. You could have written it as integral del xi from one point to another point. Right? And the result doesn't depend on how which integration quantum you choose. The definition of this is that you integrate del xi from one point to another point and the result doesn't depend on which contour you choose.
So why can't we have a piecewise continuous section there?
This is piecewise continuous, right? Here it is continuous, inside it is continuous.
Yeah, but then we do have to kind of add the correction term, okay? It's not like...
Yeah, so if it's piecewise continuous, right, then whenever there is jump, you have to add a correction term. So piecewise continuous means that you, each piece, it will be a continuous section. Okay. And but at the boundary between two pieces.
Yeah, so that would mean upstairs it should be a continuous function in some sense, right?
Yes, here it's a continuous function. Exactly. And we have this, right? So here it's continuous. Here it's continuous. Okay. But across the boundary, there is a discrete jump, okay, which I am calling 0,1 half and 0,1 theta. Right, maybe I am not clear.
Okay. I was just trying to think that instead of doing this vertical shift, which of course I understand that like there is a general independence in the process of doing this. But suppose instead of doing that, I just took two sections which have overlapped downstairs.
Which have?
this overlap on MGM.
Okay. Yeah.
Whether I can just set up corresponding patching function downstairs and patch it.
No, then you still have to add extra connections here.
Because of.
And you can also do that because you are, I mean, in this region, you are presumably take a weighted sum of these two sections, right?
Yeah.
But because you are taking a weighted sum of these two sections, then you still have to add a collection, extra collection term.
Okay, so it's the same thing, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
in that case, we will be writing in a totality fashion. Yeah, I mean, it is possible. I mean, one can, I mean, it's easiest to visualize in this fashion.
Okay.
But once you have understood what to do here in these cases, one can also generalize to cases when it has a sudden jump. Okay, so you take a section here. Another section here, extend it, okay, and it has some overlap. And in this region, you slowly change the weight factor from 1 here, 0 here, to 0 here, 1 here. Okay, and there is a prescription that you can give as to what collection you have to add in the overlap region.
Okay, it's
probably just a refined version of what you just said.
Meaning, it's easier to find a prescription for this after you have understood what is. Because here basically there is one extra ingredient, right? The weight factor.
Yeah.
Which in this case just goes from 0 to 1.
Yeah.
Okay, because here you are adding corrections only at the boundaries. There you have to add correction in every overlap. Okay, now to see the complication of this procedure, let's consider the case of two PCOs. Suppose you have Z1 and Z2. Now this will be a symbolic listing for both Z1 and Z2. Okay. Even though I have drawn only one axis, it's like Z1 and Z2. And imagine that for whatever reason, okay, we want to make a change where on this boundary it is given by Z1 hat and Z2 hat. And here I want to make it Z1 hat and Z2. I have to change both, right? Maybe there is a spurious singularity and in order to get rid of it, you have to change both. Okay, it could happen. Okay. The important part is that you have to choose the Z1 and Z2 hat so that there is no spurious pole outside, and you choose Z1 tilde and Z2 tilde in such a way that there is no spurious pole inside. Now the question is how we do this boundary, right? Z1 and Z2 hat changing to Z1 tilde Z2 tilde. It turns out that in this case, there are two possible ways you can things you can do. One is that you first change Z1 hat, Z2 hat, to Z1 tilde Z2 hat, and then to Z1 tilde Z2 tilde. Then, second way is that you take Z1 and Z2 hat to Z1 hat Z2 tilde, and then to Z1 tilde. If you try to change both, then the integral becomes integral. If you try to change both simultaneously. Okay, you first change Z1 hat to Z1 tilde, and then Z2 hat to Z2 tilde, or the other.
What are you trying to change?
I want to change that below we have Z1 and Z2 hat as a location for two PCOs. Okay. given as a function of the circle. Above we have 0 until the z to tilde on this, and have to integrate over this section, right? So as you go up, z1 hat z2 hat, we have to change to z1 tilde z2 tilde. Okay? Now the point is, how do we do this integral? Okay? So what I am saying is that we have to divide this cylinder into two parts. In the first part, z1 hat z2 hat, z1 hat changes to z1 tilde, z2 hat remains unchanged. Okay, so here it becomes z1 tilde z2 hat. Then in the second part, it changes to 0 until the second.
Do you think we do 0 integration first and then they get something like that? Or,
Yeah, exactly. That's what this means. Eh? That here you do the 0 integral first. Because this part, okay, the particle segment will be given by just dz1. Right? Because only z1 is ready. Along this part. Right? As you go up vertically. In this part, z2 is varying. Okay. So this part of the integral will be given by z1 integral. Okay. This part of the integral will be given by the z2 integral. Okay. Or you can do this. Okay, that's a different possibility. Okay, so here, as you the integration over this cylinder, you can define it two different ways. Then first, you change in this way, and then or you change in this way. Well, it will not be path independent. Okay, so let me draw another diagram, then it will become clear.
The final answer should
be. So we'll see how the final answer is. Okay, it will not be totally independent of the path. So now it's a different viewpoint, okay? 0 and z2 plane. Okay, these are complex variables, but I'm drawing them as here. So let's draw these four corner points. So this is z1 hat z2 hat. This is z1 hat z1 hat z2 tilde. This is z1 tilde z2 tilde. This is z1 tilde. So what you are saying is that if you keep the base point fixed and just do the integration over this five vertices, then one possibility is that you go along this one. Okay, as you are moving along the five direction, we know the initial five points. Z1 hat z2 hat to z1 tilde z2 tilde. That's where you have to go. So you can go like this. Or you can go like this.
Can't I take any path from this? This starting point to this same point.
Well, if you try to take any path, right, then the integral will be different. The important point is that along one path, right, integral dz1 del psi z1 is given by xi between the two final point and end point. That's the same reason why you did try to do the vertical. Choose the vertical segment. Okay, otherwise you could have practiced any path here also, right? Okay. So the point is, if only one z changes at a time, okay, the integral is well defined without any problem. Okay. So here, imagine the spurious singularity goes somewhere like this. Spurious singularity contour is like this. Okay. Here what will happen is that the cylinder, so in this path, the spurious singularity will pass out in the in this okay, that is the second part. The spurious singularity will pass out in the first segment, right? Because it is going through in the first segment. Whereas if you choose the other path, the first path that I have taken, that is this one, here also it is going out through the first segment. But the first segment here is defined as when z1 hat is changing to z1 tilde. Okay, whereas here the first segment is when Z2 hat is tangent to Z2 theta. Okay. So the part of the cylinder, see, we know that the spherical singularity has to go out from the cylinder. Right? It could go out from the bottom segment or the top segment. Different description, these, between these two descriptions. Right? Where it goes out to differ. Because the paths for this and this are quite different, right? Even though you are drawing as a single cylinder here, it's actually a two-dimensional space. Right? That's what we see here, right? I have drawn it here as just one possible direction, but this line is crooked. Right? In this part, one variable is changing, in this part, another variable is changing. Okay? So these two parts are actually orthogonal, right? Okay, so how the spurious pole passes out could vary. But you have these two different paths.
So that line now is a four-dimensional four space.
Which line?
That pole.
No, spurious pole is still four-dimensional two. Okay? So see, you have to think of this in a. This is an abstract representation, right? And most of these will not. This is still a cylinder. Okay. You can think of this, think of the base and two dimensional space, right? This is still a cylinder. It's just that this part of the cylinder extends in one direction on the fiber. This part of the cylinder extends in a different direction. Right? That's what we are seeing here. But the dimension of individual parts do not change, right? It's just that this part is orthogonal to right? Because in one part Z1 is changing, the other part Z2 is changing. Right? I have just drawn it as one particle segment. Okay? So this is like going like this and this, whereas this is going like this and this. Okay? You can think of it. Yeah.
So this is the case where when you get the singularities of this theta function. The denominator is 0, but now it's dependent on Z1 and Z2.
Yeah, in general, the denominator depends on all the sets. Right, if you look at the theta function, the denominator is dependent on all the sets. Okay. And what you are saying is that you want to change both Z1 and Z2. Then you may be able to get by changing one set. Okay. But you may not. But for some other reason, you may want to change both sets. Okay. So the general situation is that you want to change all the sets. Right, from one patch to another patch. Okay. This is the simplest one after the, this is the next, next simplest one after the simplest one, which is just one change. But this is what we have.
Can't it do follow suppose I connect this hat thing to the final point in a straight line and I need to find some coordinate such that one coordinate finds only along that line and there is some other coordinate and I take the projection of this delta so I think.
But the structure of the omega is very important here. Right? The structure of the omega is such that once you pick the delta I z1 dz1 term, right? Mm-hmm. Once you pick the dz1 coefficient, the rest becomes independent of z1.
Yes.
Right? That is the importance. You put an arbitrary linear combination of z1 and z2, that cannot happen. Right? Suppose you take z1 plus z2 as one variable and z1 minus z2 as one variable. Then by picking up the coefficient of dz1 plus dz2, you will not make it independent of the rest of the things independent of z1 plus z2.
It is not simplified.
Exactly. Right? So here, that was the important point, right? That structure of the integrand, put in the definition of omega, once you pick the dz1 coefficient, right, delta is the z1, dz1, that's the full z1 dependence. Right? And that's why we could do this integral over z1 without worrying about anything else. Okay, that simplification will be lost if you try to arbitrary linear combinations. Right? That's why you can't integrate like this, which is what you are suggesting. You have to make sure that when you intersect the spurious pole, in that part, only one z is changing. Okay? Which z is changing doesn't matter, in which order it doesn't matter. Okay? But only one z should be changing as you go to the spurious pole.
What if the locus intersects the opposite sides?
Opposite sides, that's also okay. You want to, like this.
So there, these two are not different, right? Both are when z, one is being integrated, it is intersecting.
That is true, yes.
So it doesn't matter whether I do the z1 first or the z2 first.
Well, the point is, we have to pick a path anyway, right?
Yeah, I mean, yes.
Okay. See, how the spurious poles is right. intersecting will not matter, because at the end, the result will depend only on the corner points. Right? But nevertheless, if you... So all you need is that at the corner points, that's your loss spurious thing, right?
Those are special...
Exactly. Yeah, so we choose your z1 tilde and z2 tilde so that when you draw this square, none of the corner points suffer from spurious thing. Because the result of the integral will be expressed in terms of the corner points.
In this case, z2 integral would be given.
Which case?
In this case, the spurious pole lies.
Well, the point is that in all cases, the z2 and z integrals are trivial data, because the fact that there is a spurious, whether there is a spurious pole or not, right? Ultimately, the result is psi of z2 minus z2 initial minus psi of z2 final. So, whether there is a spurious pole going through or not going through, doesn't really matter. Okay. So let's do this integral anyway and see what we get.
Can the pole line intersect both the red lines? The red line that you have drawn.
Well, if it intersects both the red lines, yes, it can. But what this means is that you actually didn't need to avoid a spurious pole; it entered and went out. Right. So if the red line, if this spurious pole intersects both red lines, right, that means the spurious pole locus. Is something like this.
I could have drawn cleverly this section so that it never intersects.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so, but it's certainly possible, right? I mean, in this description, eventually, right, when you try to give this description, we'll not always worry about whether there is a spurious pole passing through, right? Because that's very difficult to keep track of. Right? Whether there is a spurious pole passing through or not. What you have to ensure is that when we specify the picture changing apart locations in each segment, at the boundaries, all the corner points like this are free from spurious singularities. Okay, whether there is spurious singularity in the interior or not, it will not matter. Because the final result will not be sensitive to those. Now let's see what this procedure, let's say this one, this is number one. Okay. So if we choose this path, we can again ask what does it translate to on MG event, right? Because you are after all integrating over, should be able to write it as an integral over MG event. What does it translate to in MG? So translation. Again, in MGMN, the picture is that we have this B-bar. Okay, B-bar is the one on which the cylinder is reacted. Okay, the fact that the cylinder is crooked, okay, the B-bar of course doesn't know about that, right? Because the moduli are not seeing that the things around the cylinder, part of it one is there is changing, part of it another is there. Right? So you still got attention one. In this part you have the usual. Usual. Okay. Here also you say usual. Okay. The question is, what is the collection term? Is that clear? So you have to specify this omega. What do they call it? Omega C, right? Omega bar. Six U minus six plus here plus here minus one. And the bar. C. Okay, it depends on C. So here you have to sum actually over two defined terms on the one. Okay, earlier you had just integral over one omega bar on the bar, right? Here that is replaced by integral over two different terms, okay? One for each segment. Okay, we'll write down the result for the this segment and this segment. In each segment, it's what we call earlier. Okay, the same expression that we had earlier. Because in each segment, everything is unchanged except one is changed. Okay? But let me be more specific. So, in the first term, we will replace x of z1 minus delta I of z1 dz1 by xi of z1 hat m minus delta w. Z2 by Z2 hat W other Zx and Xi Xx by the usual Zb of M. Okay, let me write the second dot, then we'll be, I'll explain it. So this is one of the forms that we have painted. In the second one, we replace x of z2 minus delta I of z2 dz2 by xi of z2 hat w. Minus I of Z2 equal to 2. Z1 by Z1 T pattern. Other Z is and X is by Z Okay, so let's explain what is the difference. Okay, it's more similar to what you have here. So in the first segment here, we replace x of z1 minus delta z1 dz1 by this integral, right? Because this is what we found as a result of integration over z1 from z1 hat to z1 delta. But now you see that during this part of the integral, z2 is fixed at z2 hat. Okay. That information has to go in because unlike the other Zs, okay, which remain unchanged throughout the whole vertical section, Z2 doesn't remain unchanged in the whole vertical section. Okay? It just does remain unchanged along this. Because it has to be set equal to Z2. In the second segment, Z2 is changed from Z2 hat to Z2 delta. Okay? That's what causes this replacement. But now, during this segment, z1 has to be replaced by z1 tilde of it. Is this part clear? Because in the second segment, okay, this is what? But you still have x of z1 minus delta z1 dz1. And that part is still there. But in that, you have to pull it back to m, right? Now, z1, which function of z1, which function z1 should you use? Right? Because on the whole cylinder, z1 is not a fixed function. But because in this segment, z1 is fixed at z1 tilde, you should pull back here by using this function, z1 tilde. Okay, in the first case, it's z2 hat, z1 tilde.
Using w as a coordinate.
Now this is clear, what you have to do here. Right? Just exchange 1 and 2. Because here 2 will change first, right? And then 1 will change. Where does spurious police crossing etc. are quite irrelevant for this, right? Because when you specify the actual form that you have to integrate over MGMM, you don't care what the spurious poles are. Okay, all you need is that at a corner point, because ultimately the correlation functions will involve the corner points. There should be no spurious poles at a corner points. Okay, that's all you need.
Since this z1 and z2 dependent, when you come to this hyper.
Yes.
So this shouldn't be.
No. See, the point is that in this piece, then because you are doing integration over del z, dz1, right, the, it comes only from the del z part. But in this part, z2 is fully there, right? X of z2 minus del z is z2 dz2. Right? That is there. Now it happens that z2 is constant along this part. Right? So, so dz2 part is not relevant for this. But there is x of z2 floating around, right? So what z2 you should use? You should use z2. And that's all it says. Okay? Whereas on this side, okay, again, z1 is constant, so dz1 part is z1 has to replace by z1. Okay? But the important point is that if you use this path, it's a different description. Right? And the results are in general not the same. Because it, you get a different form, right? On the boundary. Okay, the this part and this part is the same. Right? But what correction you add to the boundary is different whether you use this one or that one.
If the difference between the two questions, suppose I do this integration along this part, yeah. Again I do this along this part, I get the difference. So only the chi z2 hat minus chi z2 tilde like that, means for each part.
Yes, so you are going to calculate the difference.
So that will be okay. A total derivative of the qb. That will be like a total derivative part, right? Qb is I.
Well, it should be a total derivative part, but what I am saying is that we will have to calculate what the difference is. Right? And again, if you directly try to work in MGMN, okay, it will be very difficult to, well, not very difficult, but it will not be very easy to figure out this difference. Okay? At least it's not geometrically obvious what the difference should be. Okay? But it becomes clear if you work in PGMN. Okay? Even though here you may be passing through spurious singularities and all the manipulations may not be quite kosher. You can work out what the difference will be, okay, and then translate to a statement in MGMN. Okay, so let me explain what the difference between these two prescriptions will be by working in PGMN. So let me call this C1 and this is C. Okay? This is two different paths. Okay, initial and the final configurations are the same, but two different paths that we are taking. So if you take integral over C1, you guys draw the figure. you have to explain alternately. Okay, so what you are doing is the following. We have this surface in PGM. Okay. Now, as it stands, as I have drawn it, it looks like a unique one. But what I have said is that it's not actually unique, because what I mean by this is different with those. Because this is not a one-dimensional space, this is a two-dimensional space. It's going from one corner to another corner of the rectangle of the square. Okay? And you could go either along this direction or along this direction. Okay, so there are two different choices with this.
Can I jump in choice as I go along B bar?
As you go along?
I mean, this choice is to make for all points on B bar.
All points on
for each point of B bar we have a choice.
Yeah.
So can I jump my can I suddenly change my choice?
Well yeah, you can. I mean, we will discuss the general case later. Right? You can. So basically that will mean that this will be decided when three boundaries meet and you jump in one way here and another way. Okay, so we'll be describing this, but right now we have fixed a notation that on B bar it will be uniform. Okay, we don't want to make any jump on B bar. And we just want to see what is the difference is.
What was the question?
That whether on B bar you can make a jump. As you are moving in B bar, it can be discontinuous. So you have assumed that the cylinder here it's a continuous function, upstairs it's a continuous function, right? But his question is whether you can make a discontinuous jump in the as you are moving inside the bottom, at the bottom below, right? On the circuit below. Okay, so you will consider in the most general case later, okay? But right now, let's calculate the difference between these two cylinders. Now, from this figure, it's clear that the difference between these two cylinders can be evaluated using Stokes' theorem. If you forget about the spurious poles, this is a surface, that's the third surface. Here there are no boundary terms because in these regions, of course, the surfaces are identical. Right? There is no confusion. Only in this part, the one surface which is going like this, in the other surface it's going like this. Okay, and you have to calculate the difference. Right? So difference will be given by the Stokes theorem. Okay? So this is given by integral of the subspace of PGMN bounded by C1 and C2. So this is the cylinder C, right? I am talking about two different choices of C. First choice for cylinder, second choice for cylinder. So what does that difference amount to? So this picture is for every fixed point on the base. Then for every fixed point on the base, you go up like this or go up like this. So that means that the space over which the space that falls in between C1 and C2. So this is a 6G minus 6 plus 2M plus 2N plus 1 dimensional space. Okay, because two spaces each, 6G minus 6 plus 2M plus 2N dimensional, they are, the volume that they are bound in between is one dimensional high. Okay, because the boundary of these are these two regions. So that we complete this, P omega 6G minus 6 plus 2M plus 2N, that's all. This is already a form of one hand. Right? Because this is omega, right? Which has certain dimension. This is d omega has 1 degree higher. And that's what you need to integrate over a subspace which is 1 dimension higher. Is this clear? What is happening? Right? Two surfaces, right? Each 6z minus 6 plus 2m plus 2n. Right? We are trying to calculate the difference in the integral of what these two in subspaces. So difference is given by the Stokes theorem as d omega integrated over the volume that is bounded by these two subspaces. Right? That's this integral.
Can this integral be thought of as a closed loop integral? Because we are going from this to this and minus.
Well, yes, you can. I mean, it's the difference between this and this, right? So you can also think of the difference as closed loop integral. Right? And Stokes theorem expresses this as surface integral. That's exactly what you are doing. So this is given by omega
6z minus 6 plus 12 plus 5. On 2a.
Right? This one a, let me put the argument. Okay, which you know, yeah, you know how to construct arbitrary omega. That's a general prescription you have already given. Now, what is this space? This space is basically that for every point on that circle, this circle, which is the base coordinate, right? This is what is labeling the base, I'm saying it. Right? On every point on this base, we have this square. Right? So the integration can be thought of as an integration over this square, okay, which is two dimensional, followed by the integration over this base coordinate. Right? The base coordinate is 6z minus 6 plus 2m plus 2m minus 1 dimensional, right? The square is 2 dimensional. So if you add 2 to 6z minus 6 plus 2m plus 2m minus 1, you get exactly 6z minus 6 plus 2m plus 2m plus 1. So the volume that is bounded between the two is one dimensional higher than the dimensional of normal space. This is one dimensional lower than the normal space. And this is two dimensional, so everything fits together. Okay? At every point on this base, we have this cylinder, which is what you have painted here. Is this clear? Now you see on this cylinder, what are the parameters which are made in PGMN? None of the moduli are vary, right? None of the local coordinates are vary. Only z1 and z2 are vary. So when you try to do the integration over this square first, okay, followed by then you will do the integration over the base coordinate. To do the integration over this square.
So this integration, sine integration dz1 and z2 never change, it's only one of the
things. Yeah, but once you express this as a volume integral, see, it is true, here one is changing, right? Here one is changing. But once we apply this, right? Now over change, because now it's the integral over the square. Right? So z1 and z2 are both changing. Is that clear? On this square. So we have to pick the coefficient of dz1 times dz2. Is that clear? Dz1 is yes, dz, right? That's the only part in the expansion. If you want to get a non-zero contribution from the expansion of omega, you have to pick a coefficient of dz1 is dz. And that you know what it is, right? Okay, what is the coefficient of dz1 is dz?
There is a
relative
sign between these two.
Yeah, there is a relative sign between these two. Between these two. Yeah, so that's why you get the Stokes theorem, right? Because one is like this minus this, right? So minus this means you can think of this as a closed contour, and then that becomes the Stokes theorem. Right? That becomes d of this. So del z is z1, dz1. Okay, I'll not be very careful about the sign. Dz2. Integrated over the square. Okay? We'll do this integral first, then we'll integrate over the this. Over this. So this is very easy, right? This is xi of z1 tilde minus xi of z1 hat times xi of z2 tilde
minus I of theta.
Okay, so even though inside the square there are spurious singularities etc. passing through, formally this integral is just depending on the coordinate point, so there are no spurious singularities. Is it clear? Either C1 or C2, and I'm calculating the difference between doing the integral of C1 and the difference and the integral of C2. Because these are two different prescriptions, right?
So there will be different answers.
There will be different answers. Okay? I have to see what the difference is. Yeah, there will be different answers for general amplitudes. Right? I have to calculate the difference. This is the difference. Right? So now I'm going to translate this to what it gives on A. Okay, I'm just using this. Yeah, yeah, but we are not really getting different answers. Because you remember that there is this QBS sitting here. So if A is on shell, this will vanish.
Oh, it's only for off shell.
Yeah, for off shell you will get different answer. Mm-hmm. Which you know of course, choosing different sections, right? Okay? But for on shell it will be zero. See, it's basically the same. See, earlier you are thinking of applying Stokes' theorem using sections, right? We are doing exactly the same thing. These are two different sections, they will get different answers for off-shell amplitudes. The problem is that if you try to think of this really as manipulations in PGMA, okay, you have always this worry that there are spurious singularities hanging out all over, right? You are integrating these over spurious singularities, right? So, does that make sense, the final, what you are doing, right? You are integrating over a section, right? A volume bounded by two choices of sections, and inside that volume there are spurious singularities running around, right? So what I'm trying to do is to re-express all the identities, that is using Stokes' theorem etc. that we got, okay, as identities involving integral over MGML, where there are no spurious singularities. Right? And we have achieved this here by expressing this part of the integral by this. Okay, and the correlation functions involving these do not encounter spurious singularities because these basically involve the size at the quantum parts. Okay, so let me just give the final statement and then I'll stop. So what this says is that integral over b bar of omega c t minus c plus qm n minus 1 of C1 minus integral of B bar omega 6 G minus 6 plus Qn minus 1 of C2. Okay, so this is the omega that you get by using the contour C1. This is the integral that you get by integrating using the contour C2. Okay, C1 is this one, C2 is this one. This will be given by again an integral of B bar of omega six z minus six plus three plus three minus one b b. Okay. But now a will be replaced by q b. Okay, so let me now specify what this is. Okay, how we construct this. B, yeah, B is this. So B is basically this square. Okay? But so this is, I'll define this object. Okay, this omega. What this object means. Okay? So this basically means that we replace, start with the usual expression for omega. Omega and replace and then we use xs by xs of m and zda m by zda by u. Okay, so for 1 and 2, you make this replacement. So this one, you replace by this, and that comes from here. Okay, these are all functions of domain 1. Okay. Or the coordinates on the base.
Here we don't have to replace A by Q, B. UDA, right?
Where?
Since you are writing this as p minus 1 form, the second line.
Yes.
There you don't have to replace A with QBA.
No, you have to, because it came from here, if you remember. See, this, the degree of the form went up by 1, right? And you replaced A by QBA. The reason that it came down by 2 was because part of this integral was a square. Was this. Right? So you already performed two of the integrals. Right? The del z1, dz1, del z2, z2, dz2. Right? So you have this replacement of A by QB. Because otherwise this difference will not vanish. Right? You want to show that at least for initial this difference will vanish. Right? And the reason that this difference vanishes on shell is because on shell QBA is 0. Right? So here the difference, see on MGMN, right? The difference between these two different control integrals is not a integration over a bigger subspace, right? Because it doesn't make sense to go, do bigger subspace in MGMN, right? You could have run it in PGMN because there are different sections. In MGMN, it's the same subspace on which you are integrating, right? Something else, okay? Some other form. And that other form is constructed by this person. Right? That's what this means. Right? So if you do integration over C1 versus integration over C2. Right? The difference is given precisely by this object. Okay? This is still, so all are integral over B1. Okay? The important point to notice is that this has a QBA. Okay? So that if A is on shell, then the difference vanishes.
And the second line, the dz1, dz2 is not there.
Yeah, because it has already been done, this integral has been done, I have written it this way.
So that was this plus 2.
Exactly. That was the two dimensions got lost, right? We only bonded to went into one higher dimension, right? One dimensional cylinder, two dimensional square, right? But then we explicitly perform the integration about the two dimensional square, right? Yeah, and replace it like this.
But it seems that D only has information about Z1 and Z2. So why are you still writing that D? I mean, here the D has all the other P minus one only.
The D has only, yeah, because I have to, okay, I mean, it's not a usual omega, right? That's not a other thing. Right? The fact that this omega is not the usual omega, I have to put that information somewhere, right? Just like I wrote this omega of C1, right? I wrote this omega of C1 because there is a specific procedure by which you can start with the original omega and construct this one. Okay? It's not the usual pullback, you have to do some operation here, right? And then pull it back. So similarly, this d is a square, right? You have to do some operation on the original omega and then pull it back to the subspace d.
So one more thing is this, you are not just replacing del xi by xi z1 tilde minus xi z1 hat, you are replacing this whole thing, chi z1 or x z1.
Yeah, because the point is that, yeah. What, you know that because dz, because what, when you do integration over this, right? You have to pick the del xi z1 dz1 because that's the only source of dz1, right? There's no other dz1 anywhere in the integral. Once you have, and because you have this product, right? Once you have picked that, there's no way you can pick also chi. Yeah, so once you have picked up this term, then no other term in this, the coefficient of this term in the expansion has no z1 dependent. Right? That's why you could do the Z1 integral explicitly here. that's the reason why this chi of z1 has not a vector anymore.
So can I think of it in this way, that in this way the z1 is orthogonal to the Ngn and z1 doesn't have any pullback anymore on the on that b bar?
Well, the point is z1 does have pullback. Z1 hat is varying as a function of that b bar. Okay? But here we are doing this. I mean, so the point is you have to do the integration over b bar. Okay? But for every point in b bar, you have to also do the integration over the square. Right? And if the integration over the square vanishes, then it doesn't help to do any integration over b bar. Right? You have to first make sure the integration over the square is non-zero. Right? Only then you get a non-zero integral over b bar. And just to make sure that the integration over the square becomes non-zero, you have to already use up the dz1 piece. Right, from that omega, and after you have done that, okay, you do this integral, you get this. Okay, but now there is no more z1 left anywhere else, no more dz1 left anywhere else. Right, so only these have to be now part of the function of the base coordinate, right? And then you integrate about this or the base coordinate.
So the
a's
will be replaced by
q. The a's will be replaced by.
If I miss omega p, it will be d. A is also will be replaced by QBA.
Yes, all the A's will be replaced by QBA, exactly. Yeah, that's what this means. So this is a formal way of saying that it QB acting on each state. Okay. Meaning if this is confusing, think of it this way, right? I mean, if you have the product of two terms, so you have, if you look at this expansion, right, you have chi of z1, chi of z2, that's one term, and then you have minus chi of z1, del psi of z2 dz2, then minus del psi of z1 dz1, chi of z2, and minus del psi of z1 dz1, so it's del psi of z2 dz2. Right, this is the expansion, and then this is OH product with various other things. Okay. And now this product you are trying to integrate over this base times this disk, and what we got times this disk. Okay. And you are trying to first do the integration over the disk. When you perform the integration over the disk, okay, these terms have no contribution because there is no dz1 or dz2 anywhere in these terms. Right? This has also no contribution because there is dz2 or no dz1.
But they can just add and multiply with the rest of the thing as constant, right? The first term.
No, but now expand it out. So it's not multiplying anything. Right? There's a wedge product here. None of them. This wedge product from this product, part of the product, there's no dz1 and dz. Right? So this whole thing, when you integrate over z1 and z2, just vanishes. See, omega has no component along dz1, dz2, right? Its integral over z1, z2 plane just vanishes, right? Suppose omega is a dx and you want to integrate it over y dx, right?
Yes.
The integral will vanish. Yes, it's exactly the same situation here. This term, because it has no dz1 or dz2, right? Its integral over the square is a 0.
This is actually showing the fact that we are going along a particle.
Yeah, that we are going along the particle square, right? So this is 0, this will be 0, this will be 0, only this is non-zero.
That should be a plus sign.
The plus sign, yes. Okay, only this is non-zero and that's given by this. That's what I have written or explicitly here. Okay. So this statement, so the important point is that this statement was written on NGN. Has no information about spurious singularity. You don't interpret a spurious singularity anywhere because it involves only the corner points, right? All the quantities that are appearing here involve only the corner points, which are completely free from spurious singularities. So this statement is perfectly well defined. It is derived intuitively from doing integration over these, okay, which look a bit awkward because there are spurious poles going through, right? So you may wonder whether this is true or not. But you can also prove it directly using these. Because after all, these are well-defined objects, right? So you can try to prove this identity without ever worrying about what happens in PGML. Okay. Okay? And you can show that this actually holds. Okay? Because this both sides are completely well-defined objects. Okay? But it's much easier to derive relations like this by what mean PGF. Okay, even though the derivation as given here is not completely kosher because of this fact that we cannot there are really singularities here. Okay, and you are integrating those singularities. Okay, but the final result is valid and nevertheless, and in principle you have to prove without talking about what mean PGF. So next time we will try to make this into a general structure. We will try to see how we can use this to give a well-defined way of carrying out integration over the in the moduli space. Okay, so basically what you have to do is that you have to divide up the moduli space into small regions. Okay, in each region we will use some picture changing operator. Okay, some sort of picture changing operator, so which is continuous, okay, and which is chosen so as to avoid spurious singularity. Okay. And then you have to say how, what correction terms you have to add in the boundary between the two regions. Okay. But now the point is that when two such boundaries meet, okay, you have to add more correction terms. Okay, and those are the correction terms we'll add as we go along. And we will see how systematically figure out what those correction terms are. Questions?
Like, can the number of pools be more than the number of PCO insertions?
It could be, yes, because the number of poles depends on how many theta delta terms there are and each theta how many poles it has and so on. But from all you have done so far is that you have said that there are less. Look at one particular pole and try and see how to avoid it. Right? If the number of poles is more, that only means that you have to basically make this jump many more times. And every time you encounter a spurious singularity, you have to do this jump. Right? So the way we will not have to address this explicitly, because we will assume that we take each region of the moduli space sufficiently small, okay, so that there is no, and we choose the PCOs in such a way that there are no poles in that region. Okay. It doesn't matter how many poles are there in other regions. Okay. Each region will choose the PCOs in a certain way. And then you will see how to match, how to put correction terms at the boundary. Then instead of having to worry about how many times you have to make this jump, right, we'll allow making this jump as many times as you want. Okay, and that's it. So if you have to actually follow where the spurious poles are, right, it becomes very complicated problem. But you can give this prescription in a way which doesn't require knowing where the spurious poles are. Okay, all you need to assume is that by choosing sufficiently small region of the moduli space, you can choose the PCO locations so that there is no spurious pole in that region. Okay, so I think we will continue with this next week, because it will need at least one more lecture. Okay, so next Wednesday I think we will continue with this and try to give a full prescription of how to do this integration.
So the next one will be the same time,
2 to 3:30. Assuming that there is nothing else going on, there is a mass conference also going on, right? So it may again have to be in the evening.